You know, there actually are talking donkeys in the Bible. Did you know that? We're going to talk about one today, all right? And we are talking about excuses today, and I've got to kind of frame it a little bit. We're going to talk about a guy from the Bible who, first thought, as you're reading through his life, you can think, you know, this guy seems to be doing the right thing. But as you examine it, and as you see the opinion of those around him, this actually what this guy is doing is quite wicked. And so we're going to talk about a man named Balaam from the Bible. How many people have ever heard a sermon on Balaam? Couple. Hey, yeah. Okay, well, you're in for a real treat. What I'm talking about today is from the fourth book in the Old Testament called Numbers. And we're going to be dealing with chapters 22 to 24. And then we're going to make reference to some other points in the Bible. Andy Stanley did a fantastic series that I had an opportunity to do last year. It's called Guardrails. And basically, Andy's hypothesis from it is that it's wise to set up guardrails to prevent us from getting into situations where we're going to make bad choices or bad decisions. So he would see a guardrail as, let's say you struggle with drinking. You know, and you don't know when to stop. And you start drinking, you just have a hard time stopping. And so a guardrail would be you making the decision, I'm not going to a bar. That's a guardrail. Going to a bar is not a sin, but a guardrail is what you do to prevent you from being in the situation where you might drink too much. Let's say, you know, as another scenario, let's say you struggle with anger. And so you blow your top. You end up saying things you regret and you know, you leave this all kinds of people hurt and you end up having to go back and clean up your mess and things like that. A guardrail could be you knowing the triggers that lead you to anger and be able to calm yourself down before you get to the places where you lose control. A lot of counselors will say, you know, halt. Are you hungry, angry, lonely, or tired? These are kind of the things that cause us to fly off the handle. And so these are the things. So if you start to feel like you're getting angry or you feel like you're really lonely or if you're tired or you're hungry, I hear quite commonly is one of the adjustments people make when they get married or when they have kids is to recognize that sometimes when people are hungry, they'll say things that they normally wouldn't say when they're not hungry, right? And I got a couple boys at home, and sometimes we're just butting heads with them, and we'll, oh yeah, have you eaten anything? And we've learned now not to ask. What we do is you just put a sandwich together, bring it in, and push it onto the desk, and run out of the room as quick as possible. And it's amazing; you get a completely different creature in 5 minutes. We're all really triggered that way. When I'm hungry, I can be quite irritable, and so these are guardrails. The thing I want to talk about today with Balaam, though, are what I call inroads. Inroads are when you take something that God asks us to do, or you take a legal statement. This may be, you know, how you fill your income taxes. This may be how you drive. And you work on the line, and you try to get as close as you can so that you can reap some benefit from the disobedience, but it looks like you're actually being obedient. Those are inroads, right? So maybe an inroad for you is, I won't gossip, but I'm going to be around people who do gossip, you know, and I hope I don't go over that line. Sometimes I might, but I like being around them because I like hearing about other people being run down. Now, nobody gets up in the morning and says, man, I can't wait to hear people get run down. But some people are more comfortable or feel better about themselves when they hear about other people's faults. Watch any reality television or any, you know, these tell-all about the movie stars and stuff. And it's incredible. We have adulation for these people. But at the same time, you know, when they go through messy divorces or, you know, their lives are crashed or their drugs or whatever kind of thing, we're fascinated. It's like we have this morbid curiosity into their lives. And our society plays a mean trick on us this way. Our society is masterful in trying to encourage us to build inroads. It is a society where we pull people up as close to the line of destruction as we can. And then when they go over, we go, oh, I shouldn't have done that. That's just wrong, right? So, you know, we'll say, come as close to the inroad, you know, to that drinking as you can. But when you get drunk, we're all going to condemn you for it. That's what our society does. It draws us to the line and then punishes us when we go over it. But a lot of times we do this in our own hearts because our motives aren't pure. Anytime you have a legal system or a system like loving Jesus, there's always what's called the letter of the law and then the spirit of the law. The spirit of the law is absolutely essential to make the letter of the law work. Many people will look at some politicians and things and go, why did they lie to us? Well, a lot of times, if you want to win an election, what you do is you build a message or a feeling in people in order to encourage them to think you're going to provide what they are lacking. You're going to make them happy if they're unhappy. You're going to make them get higher wages if they're not getting higher wages. We're going to, you know, you're going to open schools and in your area, and that way you don't have to ship your kids to the next community and things. And so we listen to these messages and go, I really like that. And so we buy into it. And then when the person's elected, they completely change. They do the exact opposite. And we get angry. And you go, why would they do that? Well, you see, the spirit of the law for them, a lot of politicians are former lawyers. And lawyers are acute or actually trained on how to circumvent laws. And so the spirit they have is this may be the legal thing, but there are exceptions or ways to go around so that I don't have to obey that law. Lawyers are masters at inroads. And so to them, to motivate the population to vote for them, they have an ideology or an agenda. But their feeling is the people that are voting for me aren't smart enough to know what they need. And so what I'm going to do is tell them what they want so that they elect me. And then when I'm in power, I'm going to do what this society needs. And that happens over and over and over again. And our society, I mean, one of the major moral failings of our society are inroads. Our people, politicians, or even ourselves, we find ways to circumvent obedience, the letter of the law, because the spirit of the law is how do I get around it? In order for the letter of the law to work, the spirit of the law has to work. There's a reason why when you go up to a red light, you stop. And in Canada, if a majority of us didn't stop, we would never go through a green light, right? If people ran red lights all the time, and it happens from time to time, and we shake our finger, and sometimes we're kind of asleep at the wheel, and we go through. But for a majority of the time, you know when you see a green light, you drive right through. A lot of people don't look. I tell my kids, look, have a look out the side, because you never know when someone's going to be, you know, not knowing what's going to happen, and they're going to pull out. But you very rarely will slow down when you're going through a green light, and when you see a red light, you stop. That's the spirit of the law. A majority of Canadians do that. And that's why we feel safer driving, or why driving works in Canada for the most part. But imagine if you lived in a country where a majority of people felt that red lights were not a law but an inconvenience, that there was no fines or consequences for it. And so people just, based on their own whim or whatever's going on in their lives, or just distraction, ran through red lights all the time. Well, the spirit of the law would be broken, so the letter of the law wouldn't work. Okay? Does that make sense? All right, so we're talking about inroads today. Balaam is an expert at inroads. Now, when we're talking about excuses, I want you to remember this statement. You can never blame your way to freedom. You can never blame your way to freedom. What Balaam does masterfully is try to step out of the picture and make his willful choices by others happen to him. So he's trying to make them happen by blaming or transferring responsibility from himself on other people. I remember I worked years ago at a company, and I met a man who was obviously living a very immoral life. And I was really curious one time. He started telling me he was a Christian. I said, wow, I was kind of surprised. You know, I'm sorry, not what I pictured and stuff. He says, yeah, he said, I know what I'm doing doesn't look right, but God hasn't told me not to do it. And because God's never told me, if he wants me to live a moral life, he'll tell me to live a moral life. And I thought, hello, Bible, ding, 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 you know. But to him, what he did is he justified his behavior by blaming God. God must want me to be immoral, because if he didn't want me to be immoral, he would come down in the thundercloud and tell me, right? And so people often do that, inroads. Balaam's an expert at that. Balaam was a prophet. Now, he lived near the Euphrates. He was not an Israelite, okay? So he would have been kind of a pagan prophet. But here's the thing. He seems to have some concept or understanding of God, and God seems to talk to him, okay? So this guy seems to have some sort of connection to the Israeli God that we're going to see his interaction go all the way through it. Now, there's a man named Balak. Balak was a king of Moab, and he was working, had a working nation, and the children of Israel had come from Egypt, and they were wandering around the land. They had no country yet. And there were quite literally millions of them. And Balak looks out and sees all these people and has just heard that the Amorites, who were people that attacked these nomadic people and were defeated in battle, he just found out about that. And so naturally, he feels threatened. He feels threatened at these group of people who are infringing on his land or his territory. So he says, I know what I'm going to do. I'm going to summon a prophet to come and curse these people. The belief was, if I bring a prophet in and they call down a curse on these people, then they won't have success in battle, or they'll wander away, or a plague will hit them, or something horrible will happen to them. And so he sends for a man named Balaam. Balaam lived pretty far away, lived on the Euphrates River, which is where modern day Iraq is. And he calls them, and he's in, you know, where Jordan, Syria are right now. So it's quite a trip. And he sends a delegation to them. And so this delegation goes from the king of Balak, goes to Balaam, says, my king has offered a rich reward if you will come with us and curse these people. And so Balaam does the right thing. He says, okay, I'm going to inquire of God. So he goes and inquires of God, and then he comes back and he says to these men, he said, I have talked to God. God has told me not to curse them, because they are a blessed people. Okay, so God's let him in on his mail a little bit, okay? So God has told Balaam, he said, do not curse these people. That's all God had to say. But God gives him the reason. He said, because these people are blessed. They are under my protection. So Balaam comes out to this delegation, and he says to them, I can't go with you. God won't let me. Okay? Let me give an instance on this happening. Let's say, you know, I had a daughter. And I want you to know, if I had a daughter, she would never get married. She would always be with me. But let's say your daughter, you know, meets a prospective young man, and you meet him, and you realize, as all young men are, he's a young Hitler. And so you determine that this isn't a good decision. And so you tell your daughter, no, you cannot go out with this guy. And so she goes to the guy and says, I'm sorry I can't go out with you. My father won't let me. Now, what's she saying? What's she encouraging him to do? What's that? Go out with her anyways, or find ways to circumvent, okay? So Balaam comes out and says, I can't go with you. I'm sorry God doesn't want you. Because Balaam gets paid for this, okay? Like, these guys probably brought a gift. And, you know, Balaam's pretty happy with it. So he goes to the messengers. He said, I'm sorry, God won't do that. Well, you got to understand something about the Moabite gods and the gods of most people, including some Christians, is that that God changes his mind all the time. A lot of people believe God changes his mind. And so people will ask repeatedly to enter into some disobedience over and over and over again, thinking God will change his mind. Now, the Moabite gods, the Baal worship, Asherah, all these kind of things, these gods were like people, but more so, they were very fickle. And so if this God, you know, was cursing your garden, well, if you go make the right sacrifice, go all those kind of things, he would change his mind. So basically what Balaam is telling Balak is, I would like to go, but this God isn't happy enough yet. Sorry, guys, you know, I don't know why he's doing this, you know. It's just, it sucks, I know, but, you know, I can't go with you. He won't let me. Okay? So they go back to Balak. So Balak decides, you know, he's really upset about this because he really wants these people cursed. And he knows Balaam has a reputation for being quite successful at this. So what he does instead is he sends his more important people. Okay? So these would have been the CEOs of the chariot companies and, you know, the bigwigs and all those kind of things. And so they come to Balaam and with this message. The king was really disappointed you couldn't come, man. Like, why wouldn't you come? We're going to richly reward you. You know? What should Balaam have said at that point?
It's a no-go.
It's a no-go. Yeah. Sorry. For our God, no means no. What does he do instead? He says, well, you know, he said no, and I told you, you know, I couldn't do that. It, you know, for all the treasure in the kingdom, he's hinting at what his price tag is. He said, well, do me a favor. Stay the night, and I'll ask God again just in case he's changed his mind. Okay? So Balaam goes and he prays, and he says to God, you know, this delegation's come, and I know the first time you said no, but do you have a new word for me? Is there anything else? And God says, go with them. Now, as a married man, I've learned there are three phrases that cause my blood to run cold, okay? The first one is, I'm fine. Okay? The second one is, does this outfit make me look fat? And the third one is, go ahead. Now, you have to interpret what these phrases mean. And when I was first married, I didn't know. But now I do know because I'm a ninja as a husband, okay? And go ahead normally means this. Okay, you idiot. If you're so stubbornly connected to this idea that you're going to go out there and do this and make yourself a fool in front of everybody else, well, you go for it. I'm just going to sit here and be an audience and tell you I told you so later. Go ahead. You need to know these phrases, husbands, okay? What's God saying to Balaam? Go ahead. All right? You don't want to do my will? Have at it. Go ahead. But God is incensed at Balaam. He's angry at him. So you've got to get this delegation with chariots and splendor and all this. And Balaam is riding a donkey, okay? It's a good donkey. It served him well. This is actually a donkey who, for the most part, does what it's told. Okay? And so this donkey, he's riding along, and this donkey sees God, an angel of the Lord, ready to kill Balaam. And so the first thing is, you can kind of look at this as a path. All of a sudden, the donkey runs into a field. So here you got Balaam, you know, and he's going along, and all of a sudden, you know, and he's running, this thing's running into a field. He's got to go. Okay, all these important people, I do not look good right now. I can't even control my donkey. I'm supposed to be a prophet of God, and I can't even control my donkey. So he gets mad, and he beats it, and, you know, gets it back on the trail, and they're walking along. And then the donkey, they come to kind of a canyon, and the donkey sees the angel of the Lord on one side. So here you got Balaam. He's riding along, all these people around, trying to make a great impression, and the donkey presses against the wall of the opposite end of the canyon. So, you know, Balaam's leg gets scratched up, and he's crushed, and he's cursing and swearing and, you know, upset and everything. He's beating this donkey and all, hey, what are you doing? What are you doing over here? Get back on the trail. But it passes by and Balaam's life is saved. And then the third time, he comes to a place where there's nowhere to get around the side. There's no field to run in. It's just a narrow chasm and the angel of the Lord is standing there ready to kill Balaam. The donkey sees it and then crouches down. It just flops. And so here you have all these important people in Balaam and this donkey having this ongoing discussion over and over and over again. Look, who, guess who looks like a donkey right now, right? Balaam. And then an interesting thing starts to happen. The donkey starts to talk. Now that's weird enough, okay? This was not an original idea with Shrek. This is weird enough that a donkey's talking to you. What's even weirder? Balaam answers it. And donkey says, why are you beating me? I've been your faithful donkey for all these years. Have I ever led you wrong before? And Balaam says, I'm so angry with you. If I had a sword, I would kill you. He's talking to a donkey. To the people around them, this has got to be really, really weird. But then Balaam's eyes open up, and he sees the angel of the Lord, and he realizes the donkey saved his life. Now, here's where, again, Balaam makes an inroad, an excuse. He does this by sounding like he's doing the right thing, But by leaving doors open, because that's not really what he wants to do. He doesn't want to do the right thing. He wants to go with these people and get well paid. And so he says to God, "Oh Lord, if I've displeased you, I'll turn around and go back. I'm sorry I did this wrong." Okay. The angel of the Lord is waiting to smite thee. Chances are he's probably a little displeased. Does anybody get that from you? Like, I'm sorry, is that the message that you're picking up here? Like, what you should have said is, "I'm sorry, I'm turning around, going back to my cave." But instead it's like, "God, you know, if I've displeased you, I don't have to go, but if you want me to go, I'll go with these men." What does God say again? "Go ahead." But he puts a clamor on it. "You're only going to say what I tell you to say." So Balaam rides and he gets there, and Balak chews him out for taking so long to get there. And Balaam, at this point, you can understand he's pretty discouraged right now because he's between a rock and a God place. Okay? He really is. And so he's worried about his money and he really wants to get paid, but he realizes at the same time that God is going to tell him something to say that probably not going to make this guy happy. And so he's playing tag. You ever feel that place? You're between two people and there's a conflict of wills and you're kind of caught in the middle. Well, this is where Balaam is, and he's not happy. And so you hear this in his words to Balak. "Well, I came, didn't I? And, you know, but I want you to understand, it's only what God tells me to say is what I can say. This isn't going to be my words. I just want you to know." He's passing the blame. He's trying to blame himself to freedom. And you can't blame yourself to freedom. Blame will never give you freedom. So Balak says, "Well, what do I do?" So Balaam says, "Okay, well, let's go to where people are. We'll go up on a high place because high places are spiritual. Don't you know if you've ever been on a mountain, it's obviously having a deeply moving religious experience." So he goes up on this place. They build 7 altars. They sacrifice the bulls and the rams. And they do all this kind of stuff. And then Balaam goes up and comes back with this message to Balak and produces not a curse, but a blessing to the people of Israel. Balak goes, "Dude, what's wrong with you? I brought you to bring a curse. Why are you blessing these people?" And Balak says, "Didn't I tell you? It's his fault. I'm going to say what he tells me to say. I'm just a messenger boy, man. It's not my problem." Balak says, "Well, okay, maybe we'll try another mountain." Okay, now, again, this is a point where Balaam should have gotten his donkey and gone back where he's from. But instead, he continues to play along. Why? Because he wants to get paid. And so he's creating inroads. This is a highly immoral man. And so Balak says, "Well, this mountain doesn't work. Let's try another mountain." Balaam says, "Sure, let's do it." And so Balaam goes, and they do the sacrifice and all those kind of things. And then Balaam goes and gets the message of the Lord, comes back, and produces an even nicer blessing on the children of Israel. Balak, at this point, is tearing his hair out. "You're the worst prophet I ever met." See, Balak thought if Balaam showed up, he would do what Balak had sent for him to do. Why order a pizza that's not going to have your favorite toppings on it, right? But here we got Balaam, and he is not doing what Balak wants. So it's like this tension is starting to build up, okay? And Balaam, at this part, it's got to be pretty discouraged. But instead of doing the right thing, instead of nipping in the bud at that point, he creates another inroad. "Well, let's try once more." Because in the Old Testament, lots of important things happen in threes. Maybe this time God will relent. So they go up to the third mountain, a high place, over another part of Israel. They do the sacrifice, they do the prayer, and Balaam comes back and by far produces the biggest blessing on the children of Israel right there in front of Balak. And Balak's standing there going, "Oh, like, why is this happening to me? Why is this happening to me? All I want, why can't I have a real prophet? All the other kings have real prophets. I don't have a real prophet. How did I get stuck with this guy?" And they have this huge argument. And Balak says, "Dude, you're not getting paid. Get out of here." And so they part ways. Now, did Balaam hear from God? Technically, did he do what God told him to do? But he is recognized from Scripture as a complete failure. And I'm going to tell you why. And just 2 points I want to make. First of all, Balaam is constantly creating these inroads. He's constantly transferring responsibility in such a way that he can maneuver himself into a place where he benefits, okay? And he's got this circumvented attitude, okay? Now you may say, wow, what a bad guy. But here's where we got to look at ourselves a little bit. And ask yourself, is my Christianity based on me getting as close to the line just enough so I get saved, but close enough where I feel like I can do what I want and have fun? Is that a question we ask ourselves? Like, if Jesus did all the wonderful things the Bible says he did for me, and if he has created in me all the wonderful things, and if God dwells in me, and I have this promise of reward, and I have this new life offered to me, and I'm not dead and alive, and all those kind of things, then why am I constantly brushing with death, but trying to stay on the line so that I don't actually go to the other place? I met with an atheist this week and had a great discussion, and, you know, there's just a number of people I talked to and he was very much so, you know, how could you believe in this? How can you, you know, this kind of thing. I was talking to him and going around this discussion, I said, people choose to go where they're going to go. You know, it's not like God is gleeful about people not being in his presence. And so Balaam's like covering the line. So technically he does the right thing, but his spirit of his law, his motive is constantly bringing him up. And many Christians do this. I do it. You know, to where this is bad for me, but I'll indulge in it. I just won't go that far. This is, you know, risky behavior. You know, maybe I'll, you know, but as long as I don't cross this, I'm okay. I don't binge drink, but I go to the bars because I'm strong enough. I'm capable enough. I don't, you know, I don't cheat on my income taxes, but there's some stuff I don't claim because in my own heart, I don't need to, because it's just stupid that they're taking money off me for that. You know, just this constant blurring of the lines. I remember when I worked here at the college, and it wasn't everybody, but there were a certain group of people in the college who thought gray really well, and this was their philosophy. They're good socialists. They said the college is owned by the government, and in a socialist culture, the government is the people, and we work for the government. Therefore, anything the college owns is technically mine too. And so people would walk out the door with projectors and never bring them back. And they would borrow them, but they'd never bring them back, right? And stuff. Just a few people, but it was enough where we had to start screwing stuff down, okay? And tying stuff up and locking it up and stuff like this. And this wasn't the students, this was the faculty, okay? And there were many great faculty. I know a number of you are faculty, all wonderful people, and I love them. I'm good friends with many of the faculty. But there was just enough of these people, you know, cause concern. But for them, they talked themselves into an inroad in order to get what they wanted. They want a new entertainment system? No, don't go buy one. Just borrow the colleges, right? Some people are like that with churches. You know, I remember this, there's this, we ran all this multimedia equipment when I ran a young adults group. And every once in a while, somebody would come and say, having some guys over for the football game. Think I could borrow all this equipment? Thinking, well, why? He said, well, I go to this group. It should be accessible to it. That's what church is here to do what I want, isn't it? No. We actually are stewards of this equipment. So lending it to you to have, you know, this, although it seems like a really cool idea, we're kind of blurring a line here necessarily. You know, what is right and what is wrong? That's inroads. It's making those kind of things. And Balaam's an expert at it. And the second thing is Balaam's consequence of his actions are disastrous. And you say, how come? Like, this seems like a win for God, doesn't it? Doesn't it just seem like, you know, God's won here and the people are blessed and Balaam goes his way and Balak's discouraged and all that kind of stuff? It's not, for a couple of reasons, okay? First one is this, and I'm quoting from 2 Peter. It said, of people who have been unfaithful, they have wandered off the right road and followed the footsteps of Balaam, son of Beor, who loved to earn money by doing wrong. Okay? What Peter is doing is saying, the worst type of people are like this guy. Peter looked at Balaam, and he did not look at a role model, nor did he look at a happy story. He looked at the tale or the account of Balaam and Balak as a tragedy. Because you had a person who was supposed to stand for God, and because they made so many inroads, they did a lot of stuff that was technically right, but was hugely immoral. And he said his motive was greed. And this greed, think of the people who interacted with Balaam and what would they think of God from then on. Think about it. They'll think, oh, God changes his mind. Oh, God's happy with him, then he's going to kill him. Oh, God brought him all this way to make a fool out of him. Oh, God, you know, we paid him to do something and he did the opposite. This God seems pretty foolish. He seems like he changes his mind a lot, has a bad temper, and doesn't know what he wants, is incredibly fickle. How many Moabites who maybe had a chance to reach out to God, because this happened commonly, people would become followers of God, they would come to the Jewish race, and they would become a Moabite. One of the most famous Moabites was a girl named Ruth, who actually was the great-grandmother of David the king, a Moabitess who said to her mother-in-law, I will go where you go, I'll step where you step, and your God will be my God, and your people will be my people. She basically said, I want to join, and you could do that. But how many of these Moabites would go, God, why would I follow him? Because of the example of this immoral man who loved money by doing wrong. Second thing, Balaam eventually loses his life. This is the interesting thing. You wonder if Balaam went home or if he stuck around a little bit. Maybe he sniffed in the air some opportunities to make some money, because here what's happened in Numbers 31 and 8. It says, all five of the Midianite kings, this was another people, Evi, Rechem, Zur, Hur, and Reba died in battle. They also killed Balaam, son of Beor, with the sword. So this guy comes to a nasty end. And the question arises again, if this was a guy, you know, a prophet of God, and he was technically kind of a pagan prophet, but he knew who God was, why does he get killed so soon? Not only that, what's he doing with the Midianites? This is another country. So let me get this straight. This guy was a total disaster with Moab, and now he's with the Midianites. Here's the biggest tragedy of all. He wasn't a failure with the Moabites. And he wasn't a failure with the Midianites. Later in the book of Numbers and in the book of Revelation, this is talked about. Jesus, talking to the church, says, but I have a few complaints against you, Revelation 2 and 14. You tolerate some among you whose teaching is like that of Balaam, who showed Balak how to trip up the people of Israel. He taught them to sin by eating food and offered to idols and by committing sexual sin. Okay, what happened immediately after this is a Moabite king said, gather the girls, the street women, gather them all. We're going to send them in the Israelite camp. Have them be more fun than their own wives and daughters. And have the men just get enthralled with them and then bring them back to worship idols in Moab. And the people of Israel fell for it. And a horrible plague ended up hitting them. God sent something to wake them up. And 24,000 people lost their lives. Now, I want you to hear the backstory, because this is talked about in Numbers and talked about in Revelation. How did Balak know how to trip up the people of Israel? Balaam told him. You know what, Balak? I know this blessing curse thing didn't work, but if you really want to make this work, here's how you do it. And he whispered in Balak's ears, it all was disastrous. And you can't tell me he didn't give that as a freebie. He probably got well paid for that advice. And you want well paid enough that what's he doing? He goes over to the Midianites and he tells them the same thing. Because later, Joshua, the children of Israel, they go in combat with the Midianites. And what did they take back as plunder? All their women. The same kind of thing that tripped them up with Moab was now tripping them up in the Midian. Who told them that? Duh. He figured out a way to become a nauseous smell to the people of Israel by undermining them in ways, by being technically accurate, but being highly immoral. And I'm sure as he was getting paid and he was counting his gold, he said, you know what? God can save them. He'll figure them out. Yeah, sure, I told them how to get under their skin, but God will figure it out. He'll fix it. You know, it's not my problem. You can never blame yourself to failure. And what Balaam ends up doing is blaming himself into a position to where he dies by the sword and is forever viewed as a horrible person. Okay? So the challenge for us is, God, what is it you want me to do? And then, God, how do you want me to do it? Okay? So I want to serve. Okay, God, I'll serve. You know, you can be a horrible volunteer at a church, or you can be one that jumps in with both feet that loves Jesus. You could be a worship leader or a musician, and you could do it to the absolute minimum and skirt the edges, all those kind of things, and you say, well, it's not my fault. I did what I was supposed to do, and not recognize the spirit of it. You could be a Sunday school teacher. Some Sunday school teachers, they show up and they're like, okay, let's get this done because I hate this and, you know, kids are annoying and they smell funny, which they do, and, you know, all this kind of thing and I can't stand this and all that. So, you know, I just teach them, get it done. I'll just peruse the lesson on the way. I'll pick them some marshmallows because you get kids candy and stuff. They really like it and you'll be a hero. And I'll do the minimum requirements and then I get through this so I can come back next week and just sit and enjoy church. Or you go, as my Sunday school teacher did, and look at each of those children as made in the image of God and absolutely precious in his sight. And you look around that table and you see potential. And you share those kids, you share Jesus with them, you do your homework, you do your studying, you pray beforehand, and you come with a demeanor where they know that you would be nowhere else in the world but with them right now. See the difference? Both of them, the kids get taught. But only one of them do the kids get taught. And this applies to pastors, it applies to deacons, it applies to worship leaders, it applies to Sunday school teachers, it applies to PowerPoint people, it applies to sound people. Our sound guys are my heroes, they really are. These guys quite literally, I mean, whenever we get a new piece of equipment, they come prepared. They're looking at videos online, they're doing study, all that kind of stuff. Do they get paid for that? No. They do their homework and they come and they work. And nobody, you know, if a sound man does his job, you don't notice. Because he's done his job enough that nothing weird happens. And for that task, for which they rarely get thanked, although we try to thank them a lot, and thank you, I know you guys are very gracious with them and that, you can do it two ways. You can come, throw the board on, work things out, deal with the feedback when it comes and all that kind of stuff, or you can improve in your art and you can address it in a certain way. So that's volunteering. That's just one aspect. When you go to work, are you the type of person who's a Christian, but at the same time don't want to be, you know, making people uncomfortable? So maybe you don't engage directly, but you don't mind being around aspects of work that maybe are immoral or just downright wrong. And technically, you do the right thing. Hey, I go to church. I read my Bible. You know, I go. I'm a good, upstanding person. They're a student. But at the same time, the love of Jesus is not radiating from you because you don't know who Jesus is anymore. And maybe for you, the challenge is going to be, you know what? I've been letter of the law, and somehow I think I'm fooling God like Balaam was. Somehow I think God is stupid. And instead, the spirit of the law says we jump in with both feet. If you want to know what this church is about, it's about falling in love with Jesus to such an extent that you ooze it. It's an old Keith Green saying, we want to be bananas for Jesus. That's what we want to be. We want to be people that are not just obedient. Heck, good people? We can get good people in here all the time. Good people are a dime a dozen. I want alive people. I want dangerous people. I want people that radiate Christ. I want people that make big mistakes for God because they're trying to do great things for God. Which do you want to be? Because you can always blame or think you can blame your way to freedom, but you can't. You can't blame your way to freedom. It's not your mother's fault. It's not your dad's fault. It's not the person who abused you's fault. It's not your cousin's fault. It's not your teacher's fault. It's not your principal's fault. It's not your friend's fault. It's not your kid's fault. It's not your wife's fault. Not your husband's fault. It's not your pastor's fault. It's definitely not his fault. You can always try to blame people, but you will never get freedom in that. Don't follow Balaam. He was a spiritual loser. Instead, jump in with both feet and embrace the spirit of the law along with the letter. And that's all I got to say about that. Does anybody have any questions? We got a few minutes for questions. I got my cell phone if you want. I've got it on buzz. And you want to ask a question, go ahead. I'm going to sip my coffee. And question or comment?
That you had there, was that from Shrek 2?
It's from Shrek 1.
Okay.
Yeah. One of the greatest movies of all time. Yeah.
I think one of the greatest ironies of Balak was that his words are still living today.
Yeah.
And not in the way that he wanted.
That's not what I'd call a great legacy, eh?
Well, the Jewish people have a prayer that they say, I think it's every Sabbath, and it's the blessing that God told Balak he had to pronounce over Israel.
Yeah.
If that isn't irony, I don't know what is.
It is. That's cool. Yeah. It's true. He's uttering this blessing in the most miserable way possible. I got to do this, but I'm not going to have fun doing it. Anybody else? Questions or comments? Sure. Rub some funk on it, Grace. Give it.
Well, I just thought if nobody's saying something, then I'll finish off. But please, anybody else can still talk, right?
Yeah.
Well, you know, I always thought that thing about the donkey talking, it's kind of like you don't want to share that with people. They're going to think you're wonky. It's like,
yeah.
You're telling me an animal's going to talk. You know, just shut up.
Yeah.
But, you know, animals can, I'm not saying this would really happen. Like, maybe that donkey really did talk.
Wait. Okay. Are you going to talk about your dog again?
Well, you know what? You know what I'm going to say.
Sister, you got to let that go. Because I'm sure it's a wonderful, furry little varmint. Okay?
You can't hear the end of this. I'll you'll know what I'm going to say in
I'm
a few weeks.
I'm living vicariously through you. I know I love dogs, but yeah.
Well, he talks. Okay.
Yeah.
And I don't want to say anymore. If anybody wants to know, come and ask me.
Okay. All right. Go talk to Grace. You want to hear about her mutt. All right. That was funny. You know that I love you, Grace, right? Anybody else? Any questions or comments? All right. I'm just going to ask the basket people to come. They'll come with the outies first. These are the baskets from which you take things. Now, you have to understand, if you take them, you have to give them back. Okay? There's pens, offering envelopes, and response cards. If you are visiting with us, today's your first service, I want to tell you that don't feel obligated to give to KCC, okay? If you become a regular person that attends here all the time, by all means, give money. It's only money, and you know what? It's a form of worship. That's all wonderful. But today, we want what we've said and what we've shared with you to be a blessing to you. Just as Balaam blessed the people of Israel, I hope my heart is more in line with what God would want, and I'm joyously blessing you. And so we want to be a blessing to you. But one thing you can do is there's a little green card in there, a response card. If you'd like to fill it in, we have updates and emails about what's going on at KCC each week, including our concerts coming up. We have a baptismal service coming up. We have all kinds of exciting stuff. And so if you want to receive that information, or if you have a prayer request, or if a question, or something like that, just feel free to fill it in, or text me at that number, and we'll be for sure to put you on that. While we're doing this, I've assembled some quotes, and if you'd like to watch them, just to help you think and think more on this, and then we'll close in a song.
All right, well, why don't you stand, and we're going to sing a response song here. And if what Scott was saying resonated with you today, hopefully this song will help with that going forward.
Sometimes I fail, still your mercy remains. Should I stumble again, still I'm caught in your grace. Everlasting, your light will shine when all else fades. Never ending, your glory goes beyond our faith. In my soul, I give you control. Consume me from inside out, Lord. Let justice and praise become my embrace. To love you from inside out. All else, my purpose remains. The art of losing myself in bringing you praise. Everlasting, your light will shine in all else fades. Never ending, your glory goes beyond our faith. My heart and my soul, but I give you control. Consume me from the inside out, Lord. Let justice and praise become my embrace. To love you from the inside out.
Sing it out, everlasting,
everlasting, your life will shine when all else fades. Never ending, your glory goes beyond all faith. And the cry of my heart is to bring you praise from the inside out. Lord, my soul cries out, everlasting, your light will shine when all else fades. Never ending, your glory goes beyond all faith. And the cry of my heart is to bring you praise from the inside out. Lord, my soul cries out. My heart and my soul, I give you control. Consume me from the inside out, Lord. Let justice and grace become my embrace. To love you from the inside out. My heart and my soul, but I give you control. Consume me from the inside out, Lord. Let justice and praise become my embrace. To love you from the inside out. Everlasting, your light will shine when all else fades. Never ending, your glory goes beyond all faith. And the cry of my heart is to bring you praise from the inside.
There are the words of God that he has presented to you and asked. And then there's a spirit of which God asks you to accompany. God is not interested in your plain obedience. He's interested in your heart. Your obedience is a reflection of your heart. And so if you find that obedience for you has been to dance as close to the line because you can't let go of that vice or that disobedience or that reality or fantasy, then I have to ask the question, is your heart belong to God? Because if our hearts belong to God, that line has moved way back. And all of a sudden we go the opposite direction to where obedience becomes a point of pleasure and freedom and joy. Do not fall in the trap of Balaam. Okay? If anything, do the opposite. Know God's heart and live it out each day. And that is all I got to say about that. So may God bless you. May his face shine upon you. May he give you the strength and the guidance you need this week. Amen. God bless you. We'll see you next week.